know about, let's have some label things here. You must know about dyslexia, you must know about autism, you must know about, now there's so many labels, where do you stop? And probably gifted or high ability was going to be kind of down the end of that list. We thought, actually, that's not maybe the best starting place. Maybe we have to start by thinking, what do we need to know about inclusion? What inclusion is, and equally important, what it isn't. Because what inclusion isn't, simply, is locational inclusion. Inclusion, in my view, too often gets distilled into, do you have special schools, do you close special schools? Where do you put them? That's not about inclusion, in my view. So we got round the table and we discussed what we thought ought to know, not just for student teachers, but for this notion of continuing lifelong professional development, in it for the long haul, right through to teachers and managers, head teachers, because we have standards for teachers. So there's standards for students, there's standards for you in your first so many years, there's standards for you in that kind of middle bit. There's standards for you in middle leadership and standards in headship. And we matched this to those standards that we have. And the spirit of the framework is based on an open-ended view of a child's capacity to learn. So they have to think about ability. They have to think about what it means. So we're really challenging that idea that ability is this kind of fixed thing, that ability is in this nice normative distribution. So, I mean, I can see that you're actually kind of following that principle today. I can actually tell just from looking around the room, because I can clearly see that all those were highly able gifted sat over here. Right, yeah, they're all nodding. Not sure if they agree, but they're all nodding. And then we've got kind of smashing really quite clever people in this middle bit here. Thank you for coming. And then we've got the salt of the earth in the middle. That's often where teachers put themselves, by the way. And then we've got the few, as we would say in Scotland, just a sandwich short of a picnic. Or we have another phrase, not quite the full shilling. Thank you for coming. It's really kind of you all to be here. And as for the two stragglers out here. Now, see, education's kind of done that. And then we take the two bits off either end. And then we just start and create another bit again. So we're really challenging, because I once asked a teacher who works in one of the areas of this, in fact, the area that tops the league for deprivation in Scotland, have you ever worked with a young child with outstanding abilities? In other words, gifted and talented. And she thought for a minute and she said, no, and certainly not in this area. Mm-hmm. And I thought, well, no, you're never going to find one, are you? Mm-hmm. You don't expect to, you're not looking. Mm-hmm. Do you have to look differently? Yeah, maybe you do. Do you have to look harder? Yeah, quite often. But they're there. So really challenging that whole notion of a normative kind of distribution. So we've looked at this inclusion framework thing around the notion of values and beliefs, professional knowledge and understanding, and professional skills and abilities. And the bit that seems to have caught a lot of interest, we were in the Netherlands recently talking about this, is the fact that all the universities got together. In fact, I think I used the phrase that something I was talking at a couple of years ago. I said we had our feet under the table. And in many ways, what we were trying to do with your Ministry of Education here was to make sure that your feet are under the table, that gifted and talented, because they were lovely people, but they had all just got new jobs and titles. And they knew their name, I'm so-and-so, and I'm... Now let me get this right, and then they would give you their title. I do genuinely think they're still working out. Not in a bad way, by the way, I just think that's what they're doing. Well, my goodness, is this the time to be talking to them? Mm. To help them to work out. Mm. And make sure that when they are talking about inclusion, they are really talking about inclusion. Because frankly, if you do inclusion without gifted education, it's exclusion, it's not inclusion at all. And we didn't all agree, by the way. We had long debates, rigorous debates. And a colleague from the University of Strathclyde saying to me, so you're telling me, Margaret, that high-level learners are as important as us? Yes, certainly am. Mm-hmm. Yeah, we need to think about them. So we had different expertise around the table, but we were all feeding into that bigger notion of what inclusion is or isn't, as the case may be. So how do teachers respond? Well, I think like that, or like that. Because I'm also not for a minute standing here saying that this is easy. I know it's not. I know it's not easy. I know it causes you sleepless nights. I know it's hard. However, some of the things we've been working on is this idea of identification through provision, because the field, I think, struggles. We've spent years and hundreds of years trying to work out how to identify who it is, you know, and I wonder if that's maybe not the wrong place to start. Let's start with provision. So in other words, if you're in a secondary school, thinking about your curricular area, or a primary school, for your primary schooler or kindergarten, what does being highly able in whatever, or what does highly able mean to you? What would they be doing? What would they be demonstrating that would make you be able to say, oh my goodness, you're looking at a kid, they do something, you go, oh, my goodness, you know what? So what is it that they're doing? Having thought about that, then the next question is, do we provide a full range of opportunities for all children to demonstrate these abilities? And sometimes that's when teachers go, oh, I write enough. That's what my idea of high label is, but I don't actually ever give them a chance to do that. And the other thing is, we're not suggesting, if we come back to my notion here, if we go down that kind of normative curve notion, you two don't stand a chance, you're never going to get an opportunity to do this. So this lot here, and maybe some of them up here. But if I let everybody have an opportunity, there's always a chance for self-identification. And yes, it's some of the ones over here, but actually, do you know what? Andy's just done something that I didn't actually think Andy was capable of until I gave her the opportunity. How do you know if you can play the piano if you've never been sat down at a piano? We worked in a little school in Shetland, which is 200 miles north of the north of Scotland. And one of the little schools there has three pupils in it. Total population in the school, three. I don't know if you have small rural schools like that here too. How would you know if you were a good team player? Look at the next. See, that's what's wrong with our Scottish rugby team. That's why you're all So, when do you get the chance to demonstrate? And then who's demonstrating? But you see, we can't stop there because the temptation is to stop there. But that's no use. We actually need to go back to our original definition and back to the provision. Because if our definition says that's what they're doing and they're already doing it, then what are you going to get them to do now? Because if we don't continually challenge, then we're back to the, they're good enough. That's Tracy mentioned. Or the, they're all right. They'll get on in spite of you. And we just know that's not true. So we need to go back and think again. Okay, they're already doing that, so what next? What's the next step? So it's cyclical, and it's constantly ongoing and dynamic and developing as well. In practice, what do inclusive opportunities look like? That little girl there was four, and she was reading like an eight-year-old with complete comprehension, intonation, everything you'd want her to be doing. And we were doing some work looking, you know, kind of through a camera, bird's eye lens, and lots of different discussions and chats. We're having with it. And I was struck by this quote, the biggest reason we do not teach more children with disabilities better than we do is not because we do not know enough, but because we don't teach them as well as we know how. And I've kind of plagiarised, I think, basically, I would give my students a row for this, but the biggest reason we don't teach more children who are gifted and talented better than we do is not because we don't know enough, but because we don't often teach them as we know how. And sometimes that's because of where you are, and the constrictions that are placed upon you, either within school or from out with on top of you. But I think inclusive classroom, we did some work with this nursery that we brought them into the university eventually, but the point was that we had worked with staff to help them to think through some of the things we've talked about here, to think through what do we mean by high ability, to think what does it mean for you? And they finished by coming into the university. We had a zoologist, a real live zoologist with a real live snake. I have a wonderful picture of a child hiding behind a member of staff. I also have a wonderful picture of members of staff hiding behind members of staff as well. But what was interesting there, we also had in people who work in museums, which are archivists, and they brought wonderful archive material for the children. But they had to really radically think about how they used it when they were talking to the children, because the children asked them questions they didn't think they could do, because some of these children were indeed gifted and talented. Primary schools, they all often did different things. They came in to present their findings. We had staff and students come. We had a kind of symposium. And this group here were terribly impressed. They had done the flavour raspberry. They went to find out where raspberry flavouring comes from. A bee voice pop. They only told you that after you tasted all the raspberry sweets and juice that they brought. And the secondary school pupils. These were pupils who interviewed. They wanted to look at interviewing skills because in Scotland, not that I think going to university is the be all and end all, but in Scotland, it's not really in our psyche to think about trying to get to Oxford or Cambridge, for example, or top university. We don't do that. Others do, but it's not just not part of what we do. And sometimes those who do actually don't do terribly well at the interview part. You know, and then they do, they feel a little bit confident and all sorts of things. So the school here, a school in an area of deprivation, decided that they were going to work on this. But when they came to us, we turned the tables on them. This is a professor of geography here who had been asked to submit her CV and her remit. And the pupils then interviewed her for her job. She had only half read what we were doing. Oh, Margaret wants my CV and my remit. Yeah, there you go, Margaret. And she arrived and we said, oh, so you're all ready for your interview. And she went, oh, no, you've dressed properly. Oh, my goodness. She was really worried she might not have been appointed. This is a PhD student. We think we maybe raised aspirations this day. The picture of the building at the beginning, we have a 13-year-old pupil who walked off a bus and walked into a lamppost because he was so busy looking at the building. And I said, Rush, are you okay? And he said, it's just not Hogwarts. And it is, actually. And we have the quadrangles where they think J.K. Rowling, who's Scottish and wrote the book in Edinburgh, sitting in a cafe, she modelled the games of Quidditch on our quadrangles. Hence the reason for the last 2 years when you graduate, you can have your scroll and we can superimpose you on a broomstick. But that's not why we raise aspirations this day. We raise aspirations this day because natural practice was as beautiful as it was in Auckland when I arrived here this morning. Very unusual in Scotland. And when that happens, Scottish students strip off. Mm. And so the boys are walking up looking at these 20-odd-year-old girls all lying in the grass. So I think we raised aspirations. So how do we work together? I think it's vital that we work together. Work together at all kinds of levels. I think Tracy made that appeal as well, that you work together amongst yourselves. In actual fact, that whole communities of practice, something we do in Scotland, Etienne Wenger's work in communities of practice, working together, hugely important, very important. And certainly parents and teachers working together. And I think we get this scenario where you get the gifted child who's, you know, maybe six, been given some sums that he's been able to do for years, and he says, oh, I can do this, I think I'll just do that. You know, and they've become a bit of a behaviour problem. And then the teacher's thinking, well, I can't work with a group, they'll have to learn to behave. I've had situations where I've been asked by schools to work with them with his behaviour, and I'm going, well, can we just talk about the curriculum? Because I think if we get better learning, we'll actually get better behaviour. Parents are saying, I don't think they believed me when I said he was good with numbers, they just talked about his behaviour. And of course, we get to legislation and policy, and they're thinking children receive challenging education, because remember, they also have kids. But I think we need to have dovetailing narratives. That behaviour is telling us something. It's telling us maybe that I want to know more about numbers more than you're giving me the chance to know. For the teacher, they're thinking, well, actually, using different mathematical materials, that's really challenged him. That's great. Parents are thinking, yeah, they're thinking about ways to challenge his ability with numbers and policy, bless them. They're still thinking the children will receive a challenging education. But how much better when that fits together than we have these clashing narratives? So we really need to understand the young people that we're trying to support, like where they're coming from, their backgrounds, and them as a holistic person, not just as a pupil or a test score within our class. We need to have communication. We must have communication, but it's hard. I get parents phoning up in floods of tears. They don't know what to go and say sometimes to schools. What can I ask, Margaret? What's reasonable? They've got 30 children in the class and they've got six that can't read. And I want to go and talk to them about my son who can't. What's reasonable to say?